Yeah, welcome everyone to the first seminar in the fall series of Cornell's Equine Seminar Series. We have a great presenter up here for you guys tonight, one that you're probably familiar with. She's a founding mother of this series and has presented before. My name's Sarah Bassman. I'm a program coordinator with the series and I work for the hospitals. And I'd like to introduce, before Dr. Goodale takes over, a new face that's helping out with the series. Vanessa, if you wanna say a quick hello and introduce yourself, and then Dr. Goodale can take over.
Hi, I'm Vanessa. I am new to the CE team under CVM. So I help with all the events, conferences, et cetera, throughout the building and a couple of seminars. So excited to be here and I'll be helping out. You've probably received some emails from me in the last week or two and looking forward to the semester.
Thank you. Yeah, so hi, I'm Lindsay Goodale. I'm also a veterinarian, just like Dr. Perkins. And I'm actually in the Department of Animal Science, though. So I teach there and I also do equine extension work. And yeah, Sarah, Dr. Perkins, and I kind of started this a few years ago. So those of you who have been coming for a while recognize us probably. But we're excited to start off this year with, like she said, one of the founding members, Dr. Perkins. She is, has too many titles probably to spend time listing, but she's a diplomat of the American College of Veterinary Internal Medicine. So she's an internal medicine specialist. She's also in charge of the hospital, the whole animal hospital at the vet school. And she's also a clinical professor for internal medicine. She has a bunch of interests, a lot of research areas she's covered, but this is one of her many special interests. And she's gonna also tell us a little bit more about kind of how she came into horses. So thank you very much, Dr. Perkins.
Yeah, thank you guys so much for helping run this seminar series. And I'm so glad we're still at it in 2022. So I'm gonna start by talking about rhabdomyolysis today and tying up in horses. Oops, I gotta get my buttons in the right spot. And I will add a little bit more about myself. And as far as a background, I'm a Canadian and I grew up in Halifax, Nova Scotia. And I was one of those kids that always wanted to ride horses. So when I turned 8, I was able to take lessons, and probably this is Wanda, one of my favorite first time horses to ride. And then my beloved horse from my childhood, Clue, in a competition. But that's what made me interested in being an equine practitioner. And I went to school in the Atlantic Veterinary College in Prince Edward Island. And I guess I did put some dates back there. So I'm aging myself. So that's the land of Green Gables. And I did an internship in Minnesota. And I also want to put out some kudos to Dr. Stephanie Valberg, because while I was in Minnesota as an intern, she was my faculty mentor in large animal medicine. And Stephanie Valberg, as you may know, has done a lot of the research on myopathies in horses and is a lot of basis of my presentation today. But she was an excellent mentor and really was somebody I looked up to at the time. I must say I was a little scared of her at first, but she was the most excellent clinician and somebody I really aspired to emulate. So Dr. Valberg, if you're out there, I really appreciate all you've ever done for us and the horse and for helping me with this talk. So, and then I came here to Cornell as a large animal medicine resident and did my residency training here and never left and stayed on as a faculty member. And in that role, I've been focused on the horse and encouraging students into the horse practice and a lot of functions with the student chapter of the AAEP. And then my research has been mostly equine infectious disease research, which actually Stephanie Valberg told me she would never be interested in because it's too complex and changes all the time, unlike kind of muscle disorders. But I think that her work is much harder. So, and then basically a lot of infectious disease work in a research setting, which then would allow me to kind of help guide some of our infection control programs in the hospital. And then help with other things outside in the community when certain like strangles or other infectious diseases were going on. But myopathies have always been an interest of our group. And I think that's what we're going to get to now, is talking about tying up in horses. So rhabdomyolysis is a kind of all-encompassing term, but it really just means like breakdown of muscle cells. And when those muscle cells break down, they release their contents into the blood, and those can have some other untoward effects. So the main effects would be that when the muscles break down, it releases a protein or a pigment called myoglobin, and that will go through the kidneys as the filtering process and come out in the urine. And in that process, it will also damage the kidneys. And during this severe rhabdomyolysis scenario, you know, the horses are also dehydrated. So then that muscle product going through the kidney is, you know, even more damaging. And then because these muscle cells are breaking, they're also changing the electrolyte balance between the cells, meaning the muscle cell, the horse, and the blood. And so we have a drop in our sodium and chloride in the blood, but an increase in our potassium, because the muscle has a lot of potassium in it. And so this electrolyte imbalance can lead to some heart arrhythmias as well, which can be concerning in these cases. So, but for the most part, we think of the untoward effects of being mostly kidney damage. All right, so what do we recognize in a horse as far as clinical signs when they have rhabdomyolysis, or how would you think that this is going on? And a lot of it exhibits as pain. So thinking about, I think most people can relate to a time in their life where they were very unfit, and then they did too much work, and then their muscles were very tight and sore. And then just maybe multiply that by a factor of, you know, 10 or 100 for a horse with rhabdomyolysis. So their muscles are very stiff and sore, and it's a very painful condition. And the only way horses really have to show pain to us is really colicking. So they paw and they might roll, they will stretch out and posture to urinate. When a vet examines them, we'll find that their heart rate and respiratory rate are high. And then the things that point more towards the muscle being abnormal is like this picture where we're sort of looking at the backside of the horse, or we're at the withers looking back, and all the muscles of this horse, like the pictures don't really do it justice, but if you palpated this horse, you would say like, wow, the muscles feel really tight here. And same here, they get kind of tucked up and tight looking, and they'll sweat a lot. And the muscles may twitch and also feel firm. And then they'll be stiff and very reluctant to move. And they may have a really abnormal gait. So in these really severe cases, they might kind of like walk and then flick over on their fetlock for a second and just look very stiff and sore. And then it can progress all the way to being down, meaning recumbency. And then that really dark urine is kind of a giveaway, like, uh-oh, this is what's happening with this animal. So I'm describing to you a very severe form of rhabdomyolysis, and hopefully you never really experienced this in your own personal horse or a friend's horse. And that many times we're gonna be talking about horses that have maybe mild episodes where they're more stiff and reluctant to move. I'm gonna play this video, and this is actually another clinical sign that horses with rhabdomyolysis may have. And I hope you guys don't hear it. But if you watch the sides of this horse go, you can see that there's kind of this like little double clicking in the flanks. And we call this synchronous diaphragmatic flutter. And basically this is happening because of the electrolyte derangements that the horse has with the rhabdomyolysis episode. So this is something that's also recognized in horses with electrolyte imbalances, say like endurance horses, after they've been sweating and a long ride. Certainly endurance horses are prone to tying up as well, but you can have electrolyte disturbances and have this appearance of thumps as well. And the horse does make a sound, although my video, even if I played the sound for you, you wouldn't be able to hear it, but it's got a thump sound to it. And actually the little movements of the chest wall is actually linked with the horse's heart rate, because it's actually the nerve, the phrenic nerve, going over the heart is activating and causing this thumping motion here. All right, so that's always a interesting one. And whenever I hear this, I often think of these electrolyte imbalances, and then maybe the horse has rhabdomyolysis. When we're trying to diagnose a horse with this condition, we certainly are thinking back to all those clinical signs that I just mentioned. And we're also considering other things. We're thinking about, is this primary colic or is this something else, right? The horse is just showing this pain. You know, is it a gastrointestinal problem or is it rhabdomyolysis? Laminitis can be very tricky to figure out as well. So sometimes people may confuse one over the other. For the most part, they're very distinct and different. But sometimes there's cases where you're like, wow, I really have been having a difficult time differentiating these two, and I have to go through a series of steps to figure it out. And certainly there's a lot of lameness, musculoskeletal problems that will potentially be differentials in kind of the more milder forms of rhabdomyolysis. And at the time of a case of this, running a blood test will give us sort of the answer. And, you know, in the field, on the farm, that might not be all that quick for you. Here in our hospital, we have like point of care blood work machines or, you know, the lab nearby, and we'll measure these muscle enzymes. It's on a routine chemistry panel, and generally the creatine kinase or CK concentration will be increased. And that goes up really fast after an insult to the muscle. So even 3 to 4 hours after a workout, a horse will have, that has these type of problems, or when they've had a tying up, their muscle enzyme will increase. And so you'll pick it up if you're seeing these clinical signs. And it can go astronomically high. Sometimes like a horse's normal value is like 300 to 800, and a horse that's, you know, tying up in its whole body, sometimes they'll be 50,000, 60,000, 300,000. So they can be extremely high in some instances. And I should tell you that as a practitioner, I always see kind of the worst types of cases that come into my hospital. So I have the, you know, examples that are really quite extreme. Hopefully out on the farm, you know, your veterinarian is dealing with these cases on a more routine basis and not seeing as bad as the cases that we get here, or they're sending them to us as well. And it's an infrequent timing. There are other muscle enzymes like the AST and the LDH that can be helpful as well, but the CK is really the go-to one because it only increases with muscle damage. The other blood tests, like we have mentioned, there's all these electrolyte abnormalities. So do those fit with rhabdomyolysis with the low sodium and chloride and the high potassium? And then when you see the urine, this is a very dramatic example of a very, very dark urine. So you can imagine that when you see that, that looks extremely abnormal and you're like, oh, that is pointing towards this horse having rhabdomyolysis. Now, there are other conditions like hemoglobinuria, so blood products coming through the kidneys, but you'll have a different set of other clinical signs to go along with that. So all of these sort of examples sort of fit here. This is another horse that was, this is the urine from this horse, and you can't tell from looking at the picture, but these muscles of the gluteal area of the horse were very kind of edematous and firm, and this horse was a severe tying up. Some more advanced diagnostics that we do for myopathies is actually muscle biopsies. And I do believe that, you know, part of the take home message maybe for this talk is that in many instances, these may be indicated. You know, so if there's things that you're not figuring out, as we go through some of the different types of muscle disorders horses can have, the muscle biopsy really can be quite helpful in kind of making the final diagnosis and then making your plan for your treatment. There are two types, mostly one using an instrument that's sort of like a, you know, the size of a pencil, and it gets like a core biopsy, like the size of a pencil width. And this is an example of taking it from the gluteal muscle. We can do muscle biopsies from the semimembranosus, semitendinosus region, which we call it just a surgical biopsy. So we're just like, you know, doing like a little surgical approach with the incision and getting a piece of the muscle. And then in general, most people in the US will be taking those samples and putting them in formalin or putting them in saline and then shipping them overnight to the University of Michigan for the neuromuscular lab to analyze them. And that's because they have to do these special stains to test for all of these different myopathies. And so this is just an example of the histopathology of a kind of regular stain. And there is a lot of inflammation or different types of cells within the muscle cells in this given case. So, so that's what they're looking at. And then, you know, we'll get the report back from the lab saying, you know, what they think after they've looked at all these different stains and assessed your clinical history. All right, so when we've seen one of these acute episodes of rhabdomyolysis in a horse, it's certainly the ones I've just described to you are quite severe, and you certainly want to be calling your veterinarian and having them help you with the management. So making sure that you have the right diagnosis and then managing it correctly and trying to ensure that you don't have any of these secondary effects. And so, you know, in general, we want to rest these horses, but we don't really want to keep them stuck in a stall. So like complete stall confinement is not necessarily the best thing, but you don't want to force them to exercise either. So after maybe a day of stall rest, just getting them into a small paddock where they can have free exercise. So if they are too painful to move around, they won't, but if they have a small area and they can still move around, that's good for them. And we want to continue to maintain their hydration because remember, if they're dehydrated, then that's when their kidneys can get damaged more. And so providing water, another bucket with electrolytes in it can be quite helpful. And then if your vet, you know, sees the horse and feels like IV fluids are also indicated, that might be part of the treatment plan. And then as far as pain control, it's mostly using non-steroidal anti-inflammatories like phenylbutazone. Sometimes veterinarian may also add like azepromazine because it really does seem to kind of relax the muscles relax the horse as well. So that's more of a sedative. And then antioxidants like vitamin E may be helpful in some of these cases, but it's not really a direct therapy. Okay, so when we're managing this horse with the, you know, the dark urine and the tight muscles, it's gonna be a little while for that horse to get better, but certainly, you know, with patience and time and allowing them to slowly move around and controlling their discomfort, they should do okay. Hopefully, you know, not developing renal or kidney disease afterwards. So we're really, our goal here, my little arrow, is that we're going to manage that acute episode, and then we're going to try to, like, you know, put our thinking caps on and figure out the real cause of the rhabdomyolysis, and then also then be able to figure out how we can prevent the horse from going into an episode like this again. Okay. So there are many, many different causes of rhabdomyolysis in horses. And I'm, you know, certainly not going to be able to go through them all today, but I will go through some of the key ones. And starting from the top here, we have sporadic causes of rhabdomyolysis, which are kind of like trauma, right? Like a horse runs into a fence and has muscle trauma. Or, you know, the example I gave where you're unfit and you overexercise and you're exercising in the heat and they sweat a lot and lose a lot of fluids and electrolytes and they're dehydrated. Those are sort of reasons for kind of a sporadic rhabdomyolysis. And then otherwise we have kind of dietary and electrolyte imbalances that may contribute as well. But I think a lot of times we're kind of considering these genetic disorders. And some of these, we actually haven't been completely proven what the genetic cause is. But I'm going to go through polysaccharide storage myopathies, number 1 and 2. And then we're going to talk about also recurrent exertional rhabdomyolysis. I won't have time probably to talk about the immune-mediated diseases, and they're less common, but certainly out there. There are nutritional causes of rhabdomyolysis. So where I'm located in upstate New York, we have a soil that is deficient in selenium, and that can lead to white muscle disease. And that's generally seen in bulls. And then there's some toxic causes as well, and I'll go through ionophores and this atypical pasture myopathy very briefly. And then in a hospital where you're anesthetizing horses for various surgical procedures, sometimes they might take a long time. Sometimes it's sort of positional anesthesia plus the inhalant medications that they're breathing on the ventilator that lead to, you know, changes in their perfusion of their tissues, and they will develop a myopathy after anesthesia. And sometimes it's actually not even the down limb that's being kind of compressed. It can be the up limb and how it's positioned as well. So in a hospital where you're doing a lot of surgical procedures, anesthesia can be a reason for a horse to tie up as well. All right, so I mentioned that ionophores were a toxic cause of rhabdomyolysis. And most of you on the line are probably equine interested, but the ionophores are actually given to food animal species, mostly for growth promotion, and then also to prevent coccidiosis, which is a parasite that causes diarrhea and infections in mostly younger animals. So they see it a lot in cattle and swine and sheep and all these other species. So these medications are used in them to help prevent those diseases. And they're very commonplace. And some of the names are monensin or lassalosid. And basically there's different susceptibilities of different types of animals, and horses are very susceptible to this medication, meaning it takes a very, very little bit of an ionophore to make a horse sick. So, and in fact, it can be extremely low amounts and horses can die from this condition. And the way that horses come into contact with it is actually from mixing errors at the feed mill, meaning, you know, the feed mill is a, you know, small backyard feed mill, and they're making some feed for these three horse farms and these 50, you know, food animal farms. And somehow some of the food animal stuff gets mixed in with the horse feed. And remember, the horses are so susceptible to it that just a very low dose can make them sick. So the most recommendations are, you know, the commercial feed companies are doing everything very separate, lots of rules and regulations. And then also thinking about when you're at a livestock show or other things to avoid contact with other animals' feeds. And then to keep those other feeds kind of locked away, you know, not letting horses eat through the feed trough of the cow or the sheep or goat or whatever it may be. And certainly here in our hospital, you know, over the years, I've had to make sure that we're not getting cow grain that has these things in it, because they could end up in the horse hospital as well. So, and they're very commonplace in the feed of other species. And I should say there have been horrible reports of, you know, a whole horse farm being exposed and, you know, having many animals succumb to this toxicity. There's also a lot of seasonal pasture myopathies that were reported in Europe for years and nobody could figure it out really. And I think we've come to the conclusion in the few cases that we've seen in the US that it's been linked to these box elders trees and a thing called hypoglycin A. And it happens in pastured horses in the fall, because we'll get to a lot of the things that cause rhabdomyolysis are usually kind of linked with exercise. And this will be a horse out on pasture, you know, doing its own thing. And you're like, why is this horse tying up? And I did see a case of this a few years ago. And the history was, you know, the horse had been on one farm, moved to this new farm. It was all by itself in the paddock. And there are no other feed supplements or whatever provided to the horse. And there was limited grass on the farm. And within a few weeks, the horse had this condition. And it was the right time of year for these box elder trees. So in general, I think it doesn't happen so much, like a lot of toxicities, if you're also providing hay, there's lots of good grass, and the horses aren't getting into as much of these other seeds. So that's an interesting finding. There have been other ideas for this type of pasture myopathy, which is the maple leaves getting these tar spot fungus on the back of them. And you know, that hasn't necessarily been proven, but the box elder trees and the hypoglycin A have been kind of scientifically shown to induce the disease. All right, so those were some of the less common forms of rhabdomyolysis in horses, some of the toxins. And then I'm going to talk about recurrent exertional rhabdomyolysis, or RER. And this happens mostly in standardbred and thoroughbred horses. And kind of a lot of my pictures will be kind of race horses. And it happens when they're not necessarily at maximal exercise. So, you know, you'd often think like, oh, when they go out and work their hardest and gallop, that's when they would tie up. But it actually is more likely to happen when they're just in a low jog for longer periods of time. And like in eventing where they're doing the steeplechase, or in the cross country where they're actually holding the horses back. And these horses tend to be kind of nervous young fillies. And that might be part of the pathophysiology of it as well. And when we're thinking about rhabdomyolysis, a lot of times when you read the textbooks, they talk about Monday morning disease. And actually the link with kind of not extreme exercise, but more of even mild exercise. And so we're thinking that, you know, in the PSSM horses we'll get to later, that a lot of times it's these horses that were stalled over the weekend, you know, they're worked all week long, then they're rested on the weekend, given all kinds of oats and sugar. And then on Monday morning, they take them out to work them, plow the fields, and they start to tie up. So just kind of thinking about when horses are tying up in relation to their exercise and the different conditions. And I'm gonna go through both of them next. So as far as recurrent exertional rhabdomyolysis, or RER, it seems to be kind of a pathophysiology where it's within the excitation contraction coupling of the muscle. So it's actually when the kind of like twitch or the contraction is happening. And it's, again, like I said, those nervous fillies. And if we can reduce the stress triggers that lead to the rhabdomyolysis episodes, then that would be, you know, helpful for these horses. And it's, you know, kind of felt to be a genetic disease, yet we haven't found a true, you know, single point mutation. It's probably a complex trait or something that leads to it, but it is kind of very prevalent in the thoroughbred and standardbred breeds. And so if we can reduce the triggers, like, you know, having happy horses, feeding the nervous horse or the horse that's kind of waiting for the food, train that animal first, you know, have them in a quiet area of a barn with their companion, and then continue to kind of like exercise them on a regular basis using various exercise tools. And then certainly, like I said already, when they've had an episode of rhabdomyolysis, to kind of stall rest and then small paddock turnout, and then move on to kind of like these workouts where you're, you know, not holding them back, that you're doing interval training, but you're not doing excessive training. And then allowing for kind of these relaxed warm-ups for the thoroughbreds and event horses, kind of this more calm exposure to speeds during steeplechases and other things. So, you know, I think that sounds easy on a slide and maybe harder in reality to accomplish. And so a lot of the exercise things, you know, is trying to standardize and be as consistent as you can with your exercise. And then what should we do about their diets? And so in the RER diets, we're really, you know, want a nutritionally balanced diet, and it's going to be tailored to the individual horse. And basically, when we're thinking about diets, we're talking about hay, is kind of not a high sugar content hay, but a good quality regular hay and couldn't have alfalfa in it. And then moving on to kind of like, you know, these are working horses or training horses. So they do need more than just hay in their diet, and then providing them kind of a low starch and high fat concentrate. And we feel like, you know, we'll go through PSSM shortly, but the low starch is more to kind of take away that jittery nervousness of the horse, not necessarily got to do with the fat and sugars within the muscle. It's more about the kind of like active nervous horse on sugar. And so trying to shift them over to more of a fat diet than the starch in their diet. So when we're thinking about moderate exercise program, the horse probably needs about 24 megacals per day. And if we're feeding high starch grains at sort of like, you know, we're giving about 2% of their body weight per day in hay, and then we're giving 2.5 kgs per day in corn or oats or wheat or molasses, that seems to be okay for those horses, that their muscle enzymes, their CK will stay all right. But a lot of times I think we feel like the horses may need more as a horse owner or horse trainers, and they're giving more like 5 kilograms per day in addition to the hay. And they're boosting their, you know, megacals above this 24. And in those instances, actually the horse's muscle enzymes were increasing, meaning that, you know, we can give some of these sugar high starch grains, but we can't give a lot of them to these horses. And so we can, instead of adding more of these high starch to them, we could give them a high fat concentrate using things like vegetable oil or rice bran. So I think that the basic principle then would be that we feed a horse that's about 450 kilograms. That's a, you know, racing thoroughbred, standardbred, you know, event thoroughbred, giving a 1.5 to 2% body weight per day in hay. So that makes about 10 kilograms per day. And then in grain, we can give them about 2.5 kilograms per day, but we really shouldn't go above that. And if you want to add more additional calories, you should do it as a kind of high fat calories, meaning adding a vegetable oil or adding like a rice bran product like this Relieve. And I should have also said I have no proceeds that come from any company that I mentioned in this talk today. Dr. Valberg did help with the formulating of this diet. And again, you know, I have no kickbacks on that. So, okay. So we just talked about recurrent exertional rhabdomyolysis, which is a certain subset of horses and subset of work. And I think that, again, it's kind of related to this excitation contraction coupling of the muscle. Now we're going to switch gears and talk about the polysaccharide storage myopathies. And these horses actually have an accumulation of abnormal glycogen in their muscle. And we know now that they actually have a genetic mutation, which is within the glycogen synthase 1 gene, or that enzyme's gene. And other places in the talk, we'll talk about this being the GYS1 gene. And this gene is an autosomal dominant, meaning if a parent or a sire has only one gene, 50% of its offspring will still have the gene, and it can still be expressed, meaning that you only need one gene to have rhabdomyolysis or stiff muscles or something associated with this abnormal glycogen in their muscle. And so it's a very prevalent in certain breeds, and we'll get that in a second. And so we really have learned a lot about this, because back when I was an intern with Dr. Valberg, she had a herd of horses. We didn't know yet about this mutation, but we did know that this particular sire often had, you know, offspring that had PSSM, and she was crossbreeding them. And sometimes I'd be checking on cases overnight, and, you know, one of these horses would look like it was colicky, and I'd start treating it for colic. And I'd call her and she'd say, "Jillian, those are my muscle disorder horses. It's probably tying up." And I'm like, "Oh, okay." And so we really were at that time, you know, that was the way to figure out some of these genetic things was actually kind of using the breed. Now we've gotten all fancy and can do all these DNA analysis and all that kind of stuff. All right, so away from my trip down memory lane, thinking about these horses, they can tie up like that very exaggerated extreme form that I say where their muscle enzymes get really high. They're very stiff, very firm muscles, they're colicky, they pee dark urine, or they can be more like a horse that's kind of stiff and reluctant to move. And so hopefully you rarely see them develop this kind of rhabdomyolysis. And so the breeds that we talk about mostly are the quarter horse types and then the draft horses. And to go a little bit more in depth about what we're actually saying is abnormal in these horses is when we take a look at these muscle biopsies and do all these special stains on this side here, I'll get my pointer. This side here, we have this periodic shift stain, so PAS. And it has these kind of magenta looking inclusions that are abnormal glycogen or glycogen. And then they add amylase to this PAS stain and there's stuff that kind of stays there. So they're considered amylase resistant. So to be a PSSM1 case, the patient has this PAS positive amylase resistant glycogen within their muscle. So it's abnormal glycogen. And so when we take the full package of this now to make a diagnosis for PSSM as an underlying kind of genetic myopathy is that we have this muscle biopsy that's abnormal with this PAS positive amylase resistant glycogen. And then we also have this genetic test that says, yep, this horse has the GYS1 mutation. And both these things together mean the horse has PSSM1. And I should step back and say, if you're wanting to test a horse that's in a breed where it's very prevalent, oftentimes they'll only do the GYS1 genetic test and not bother with the glycogen. But if you're looking at a breed that's kind of more out of the realm of the ones we're going to talk about here, you'll probably want to look at your muscle biopsy too. Okay, so here's a chart, and a lot of the stuff is, you know, again, borrowed from Dr. Valberg's website, as well as her talk in the Milne lecture at the AAEP back in 2012. But this is showing basically that the breed of horse and then the number of horses that were positive for the GYS1 mutation out of a given number of horses, giving us a prevalence in these horses that were studied, basically. And so if we look at the quarter horses actually, you know, have a percentage of, you know, 5 to 10% within that horse breed. And whereas when we look at some of the draft horses, like the Percheron and the Belgians, those really have a high incidence of the GYS1 mutation. Now, the more British breeds of draft horses, they don't have it so much. So the Shires and the Clydesdales. And this actually has been important in our hospital where sometimes where we're getting ready for a surgical procedure, which hopefully you don't have to do too many anesthetic procedures on these very large draft horses, but we're more concerned about the Percherons and the Belgians because of this underlying PSSM1 than we are of the Shires and the Clydesdales that don't tend to have that disorder or that genetic mutation. All right, so it's really prevalent in the Percherons, Belgians, quite prevalent in the quarter horses, and then these other breeds of draft horses, not so much. All right, so when we look at the different types of quarter horses that have PSSM1, it looks like kind of your regular old AQHA registered horse and your halter horses are the ones with the higher incidence versus, and the Western pleasure horses are pretty up there as well, but less so in kind of your barrel horses and your racing quarter horses. All right, so my horse has this genetic mutation for PSSM1. What do I do? And I kind of do the same questions with our students here teaching this class. And the answer is, you know, it is good to know that you have this type of problem so that you can then manage and prevent future episodes of rhabdomyolysis. And you're going to do that by diet and exercise. I'll go through that in a second. So finding this mutation doesn't necessarily mean it's the end of the world. And there is something you can do to prevent the horse from having episodes in the future. All right, so what is the diet for PSSM1? Remember, it's abnormal glycogen, which is like a sugar in your muscles. And so we want to kind of switch over and be managing them with less starch in our diet and less sugars and more fat. Now, remember, if your horse is already fat to start out with, that probably adding more fat to the diet is not the best idea. So keeping that in mind, you know, your recommendations have to be tailored to a given horse. So again, we're going to have a good balanced hay for horses. And then fat sources can be mostly vegetable oils. And I'd say probably the majority of people are using things like soybean oil or corn oil for their horses. And then there's rice bran and then other animal-based fat. And so kind of cut to the chase a little bit here. This is a chart that looks at kind of RER and PSSM, and then the different light, moderate, and intense exercise. And so what they're saying is, you know, we have, hay that we're gonna feed for the horse, you know, 7.5 to 10 kilograms per day. And then depending on the amount of exercise they're doing will depend on how much of this, you know, higher fat content concentrate that you'll give. Will you give 2 kilograms, 3 kilograms, or 4? And then making sure you keep up with your sodium chloride and all that other kind of things. All right, so that's diet for PSSM1. And then when we're exercising these horses, we certainly want them to give a time to acclimate to this diet before you start to work them. And you also want to think more about the duration of exercise versus the intensity, that a lot of long time at kind of low duration work can still be hard on these horses, and they tend to not tie up as much again when it's higher intensity work. And that you gradually introduce them to work, that you do your work frequently, do the same thing all the time, and then reduce days where you don't have any exercise. So stall confinement is really discouraged. Having a horse turned out in pasture to move around is very good and you know, something that is encouraged. And certainly if they've had a rhabdomyolysis episode, we sort of talked about them having reduced exercise while their muscles sort of heal. Okay. So there's this other thing that gets a little confusing, which is PSSM2, where we've had muscle biopsies where the horses have some PAS positive glycogen in the muscle, and then they add the amylase and it kind of goes away with the amylase. And so this is different histopathology of the muscle. And then these horses actually, when you do the genetic test, do not have the genetic mutation. So they are muscle biopsy, they have a PAS positive, amylase sensitive glycogen, and then on the GYS1 mutation, they're negative, and that leads you to this PSSM2 diagnosis. And myofibrillar myopathies tend to fit within this category and has a special biopsy finding. Or we're kind of like, what other things can be lumped into this PSSM2 category? And so there's a lot of unknowns here. And this is kind of an area of kind of new research for Dr. Valberg's group as well. So we're finding the myofibrillar myopathies mostly in Arabians, and it tends to express as intermittent rhabdomyolysis in those horses. And I just wanted to say, these are pictures stolen from the internal, the websites. And these are not horses that necessarily have these disorders. I just randomly picked pictures from the internet. So just want to make sure if it's some famous horse that I'm not kind of say like indicating, or that you may think that they have this genetic disorder or this background in myopathy. We're not sure if it's genetic yet. And then warm bloods also have this condition. And usually the horses have been performing well until they're about 8 to 10 years. They don't tend to have rhabdomyolysis, but they have sort of these vague signs, which really could be other diagnoses as well. But they're horses that are unwilling to move forward, they're poor at rounding over the fences, they're reluctant to engage their hind quarters, they have poor canter quality. And now I have at the bottom of this rule out other musculoskeletal disorders, because those things that I've just listed off are very vague findings, right? You could have a sacroiliac problem, you could have other kind of suspensory, you could have all kinds of other musculoskeletal things that you should be looking out for first before deciding that your horse has this MFM, because it's still not all that common. And so this is a disease of unknown cause and unknown genetics, but it seems like these yellow kind of fibrils here, that this side is normal muscle, and these are the myofibrils here. These are being held together by this thing called the desmin. And the yellow desmin is very unorganized in these horses. And so it kind of gets all kind of knotted up, and then the myofibrils don't really line up very well. And so when we're looking at the muscle under the scope and a muscle biopsy, they're actually looking at the protein, this desmin. And in normal muscle, it sort of tends to be around the muscle under the membranes. So this is the desmin showing up in the red here. And then if we think about the horses that have MFM, it's more kind of clumped throughout the cell and scattered within the muscle fiber. So now this is a cross-sectional image of the muscle, and this is longitudinal, but you still get the gist that I would see the kind of little red dots all throughout the center of these cross-sectional images as well. All right, so because this is more of a problem with the desmin, which seems to be related to kind of some amino acid problems, that some of your diet and exercise recommendations are a little bit different. And so it's more about poor strengthening of the horses, consistent exercise still, and then stretching with a long, low warm up. And the diet is more based on good quality proteins and amino acids. And then if you have a horse with atrophy, or where the muscle actually is kind of, you know, gone, and adding kind of a whey-based protein supplement like that's rich in cysteine. And then you could also have antioxidants that you're giving to your horses as well, like vitamin E, or this coenzyme Q10 might be something that could be helpful. And now these haven't really been studied, but they seem to kind of like fit with the pathophysiology of what they're finding on the muscle biopsies. Certainly more work needs to be done. So one thing about the PSSM2 is that there's no real known genetic mutation or cause. We know these cases are negative for the GYS gene, but we haven't really identified other genes. And we do know there's abnormal glycogen in those horses' muscles, but we don't have any validated genetic tests. And so out in the world, there are some companies that are recommending to test your horse for PSSM2. And we do know from a few studies by Dr. Valberg and others is that those tests, when you take them and compare them to these muscle biopsy criteria, they have no linkage whatsoever. So meaning that, you know, you're running this test and it's not been validated for this disorder, and the results you get back are not things that you can trust. So at this point in time, we're not recommending doing any sort of genetic testing for PSSM2 because we don't know what we're looking for. More research to follow on that. So I'm getting close on time here, but I wanted to also say the same sort of question now is, you know, my horse has PSSM1 or PSSM2, you know, what do I do? You know, do I give up on the horse? Do I do whatever? What do you recommend? And basically, you know, the main goal is to prevent the horses from having episodes of rhabdomyolysis and to perform as best possible by doing the diets that are recommended and exercise. And most horses in these scenarios will improve, I think around 70%. In the really severe cases, especially in the PSSM1s, where like they might have both genes, those cases are more severely affected. You know, maybe you have a very diligent person who, you know, works night and day to have all their feeding perfect and all their exercise perfect, and that works for them. But there are still horses that no matter how hard you try, you're not going to be able to help that horse, and it may not perform to the level that you want it to. So I think that, you know, most cases you will be successful in having improvement in the horse's work and not having future episodes of rhabdomyolysis. But there certainly are cases where you do your best and the horse still does not have a good performance and can't be used for that intended purpose. All right, so we're getting to the end here. I did kind of throw in a quick slide about foals and white muscle disease. Basically, in this area, we are selenium deficient. And what I mostly wanted to say is that when you have horses on pasture here, or even if you're feeding a commercial grain, providing selenium can be important, especially if you're running a breeding operation, because you will have like abortions and foal deaths associated with selenium deficiency. This is a foal I saw many years ago that was tied up, like it couldn't stand. And this was quite a few days later. This is its, you know, red urine, but its muscle enzymes were like 600,000. So very, very high. And actually its cute little tongue was affected too. It couldn't swallow properly. So this foal was in the hospital for quite a long time for management. And then had a lot of atrophy because all those muscles were very damaged initially, but it did survive. How productive the horse was moving from there, I'm not exactly sure, but the key thing would be to make sure that you're addressing selenium, especially if you're working on a breeding farm. And then both selenium and vitamin E can be things that are recommended in managing other myopathies in horses, as they are sort of antioxidants and anti-inflammatory, basically. All right, so white muscle disease can happen, and it's usually in the youngsters. And to tell you the truth, when you test the dam, because often that's what I'll do here, the dam will be about half of what she should be, basically. So while the mare is not showing any clinical signs, she is actually deficient, and you will see that the foal is like half of what the mare is. That's been my clinical impression when I have these cases. All right, so thanks for listening. I guess I wanted to sum up with rhabdomyolysis can be quite severe in horses, but for the most part, there are some underlying genetic disorders that can be managed quite well, and being aware of it is important. That sometimes it can be very simple to get to a diagnosis, but other times that muscle biopsy might be the answer to being able to figure out exactly how you want to tailor your diet and your exercise program for your horse. And I think that might be all I can add here for now. So that's my summary. And again, if you have any questions, I think now we can go for it.
Thank you very much. That was great. We do have a good handful of really good questions, I think, if you're ready.
Okay.
Don't need a break for water. So I thought this was interesting, a straightforward question. Mm-hmm. Someone's asking if the tying up is only mild, will the kind of muscle tension, mm-hmm. or maybe even edema, will that always be bilateral or could it be regional?
Mm-hmm. So for the most part in these kind of horses with the under, like PSSMs, mm-hmm. or the RERs, it does seem to be kind of like whole body. In scenarios where it's more of a like after anesthesia or after a recumbency or after a trauma, those tend to be kind of more regional. So they do tend to be kind of diffuse. Yeah.
Right. Yeah. Thank you. And then, so someone who I believe is a veterinarian is asking, is lactate useful to look at? point of care wise?
Right. So lactate is the what we measure stall side is considered L-lactate, which is looking at kind of how anaerobic metabolism is happening. And so a lot of our dehydrated patients will have an increase in their lactate. So I think that part of it is helpful. But as far as the horses being in anaerobic metabolism in the kind of racing portion and then developing rhabdomyolysis, it's not necessarily that way. So remember, we're talking a bit about the horses being kind of in this milder form of exercise. It's actually a lot of times that they are in sort of aerobic work when they have tying up. So I think the question might've been trying to get at both of those things. So yeah.
Awesome. Thank you very much. So this is an interesting one, I thought, and maybe some other people are wondering this. You know, if you have a chronic, maybe mild lameness, intermittent perhaps, maybe I think the question is basically, when would you put this on the list, or how long might you notice the signs for if it's mild? When should you worry about this if it seems quite mild, I guess is the question.
All right. Well, I think that's sometimes if you have a horse in sort of the breeds that have a high linkage to like PSSM or RER, and I suppose I should just step back and say, yeah, the PSSM ones where you're like, okay, does my horse have that GYS1 mutation? That may be something worth doing. So that would be your, you know, quarter horses and your draft horses of particular types. But other than that, I think the lameness side of it, you know, if it looks like a regular lameness, we're going to try to like localize that as best possible to the, you know, right hind leg and the hock and kind of address that and see how it goes. So I think it would be more of a response to treatment and whether like the usual things are working, and then moving on to kind of like, okay, you know, I've done this, that, and the other, and this sort of thing keeps happening, but it does tend to be more of a diffuse thing and not just, you know, localized to the right hind leg. Yep.
Right. And then, so this is again, another straightforward one. Do you recommend or know anything about supplementing L-carnitine?
No, I don't.
Yeah, me neither. It's a good question.
Lindsay, you lied. You said it was easy.
I know. Oh, it's straightforward, but it's not straightforward. Necessarily.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah. I also don't know. I did a quick search and there's not a ton of research on it, although there's some in people. So maybe that's where they're getting that question.
Right.
And so this, I'm not sure if there's much research, so we'll ask you. Someone's asking in terms of like muscle or body work stuff or alternative therapies.
Yep.
Electrotherapy, acupuncture, and mesotherapy have all been asked about. Do you know of any research on any of those or the effects of them?
Yeah. No, I guess I haven't been like particularly involved on that side of things. I think that they probably have their place. And I would love it if people did some research to kind of see how they affect. It's always a challenging study to have your control groups and all those kind of things, but for sure, they probably have their place. I mean, I think in the acute episodes of rhabdomyolysis, I expect that, you know, people who do acupuncture feel like it may be helpful for those horses. But I have no basis to kind of give a good answer. So yeah. I can't say they won't. And I'm sure there are some things that would help.
Yeah. And sometimes it's, you have to go with anecdotal before there's any studies
right.
on that, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
And I would just add, obviously, if your horse is made uncomfortable by it, then don't want
yes.
to do it.
That's yeah, absolutely.
That's generally true.
Yeah.
let's see. Okay. So I think some other blood work questions. I'm trying to see if there are any other general questions. I believe we've touched on most. Were there any that were sent in beforehand that we haven't touched in, Sarah or Vanessa?
I think we've gotten to most of them, yeah. We're getting a lot of great thank yous to Dr. Perkins in the comments here.
I was going to say, and I meant to say this out loud when I, you know, was saying how great, how much of an impact Dr. Valbury had on my career, but basically her website, the Equine Neuromuscular Lab, is like the go-to place. Like, she has great like question and answer, like, you know, she does it kind of frequently asked questions type of format, and it's really very helpful. So I think if anybody has kind of questions,
great resource.
And I go to it all the time. And then like I have student labs where I make them go to it and all that kind of stuff. So it's a really, really good resource. Yep.
See, even the experts do a lot of Googling and just looking at the .edu websites are always a good bet. So thank you very much.
Probably something we can include in the follow-up as well. Make sure that everybody gets it.
Thank you so much.
Great. Thank you. I think we'll wrap it up for tonight. And just to let everybody know that the October seminar series, the seminar is going to be by Dr. Hahn on equine anesthesia. So stay tuned for that one.
Thanks, guys.
Yeah, good night, everybody. Thank you so much for coming.